As we move further into 2020, rumours of a new Assassin's Creed game dropping at the end of the year are ramping up, and since Ragnarok hype is growing more and more, I thought this would be the perfect time to rank the Assassin's Creed games from worst to best. We've got a lot of games to rank here, so I'm just gonna jump straight into it, but before I do, I just wanna say that this is just my opinion, so if you disagree, feel free to comment down below what you disagree with and your list, because I am genuinely interested to see what people's lists are looking like. There will most likely be spoilers for all 11 games in this video, and with that being said, hit like, hit subscribe, and we can find out which Assassin's Creed game is the best. Unsurprisingly to most, Ubisoft's most recent entry into the Assassin's Creed franchise comes out last on my list, and to be honest, it was kind of difficult to even include it on the list. Odyssey, by all intents and purposes, isn't an Assassin's Creed game, but even with that element removed, it is simply a terrible game. I wish that I could have enjoyed the game. I so dearly wish that Ubisoft Quebec could have pulled off a quality game set in one of my favourite settings. But looking at the game as a whole, I find nearly nothing positive I can say about it. My main issue with the game stems from the main character, or lack thereof, as Ubisoft provided a useless character selection that canonically makes no sense, and was clearly done so that Ubisoft could market a stern-looking dude in their advertisements, despite Cassandra being the canonical lead. There are simply too many issues with this game to talk about in depth, but to list off a few, the dialogue choices have no genuine effect on the story, and create cutscenes and interactions that feel like low-budget anime. The leveling system is structured in order to slow down progress, near forcing the purchase of microtransactions. The combat is tedious as opposed to difficult, with enemies being complete damage sponges. The character moments, especially in the DLC, are completely contradictory and often meaningless. Basically, all the side content consists of the same mission structure, creating an open world that whittles down to nothing more than a checklist. And that's all not even mentioning the destruction of past lore, terrible modern day, and generally abysmal, unfocused writing. Odyssey shouldn't have been an Assassin's Creed game, with all elements linking to the rest of the series being forced and usually breaking lore, whilst the rest of the game ignores the elements completely. But at the end of the day, it's more than just a bad AC game. It's a terrible game in its own right, and the gap between this and number 10 on the list is pretty sizable. This game, the beginning of the end. I wish so badly that Assassin's Creed 3 was good. This game should have been fantastic, but due to some of the worst character writing in the series, along with how disappointing it was coming off the first four games, it falls to number 10. Now, before I go into this game, I want to be clear. I'm talking about the original Assassin's Creed 3, so if any issue I bring up was fixed at all by the remaster, that's completely irrelevant here. The first issue I had with AC3 is the world, and it may be the only open world in the series that I can say I genuinely hate. A recreation of 18th century America, the world of AC3 is 80% grassland and forest, a setting that isn't ideal for a game structured around seamless free running and vertical movement. But when we get to the cities, we see the same issue that applies to the whole game. A world covered in muddy hues of brown and grey, with uninteresting locations and nearly no colour. The game's made even uglier by a clearly unfinished HUD, and this ugliness issue is a problem that's just the dressing for the terrible story the game tells. If it weren't for the first few sequences of AC3, that of Haytham making his way to the new world, then the game would probably be last on my list. Haytham is far and away the best character in the game, through his cunning, his wit, and his general charisma. His son, on the other hand, is written so unbelievably terribly that it's hard to fathom. Ratan Hagaitan begins his story as a naive child, witnessing the death of his mother to the hands of Charles Lee, and making his life goal to avenge her. Whilst this beginning for the character is an interesting one, how do I put this? It never grows further than what it starts as. Connor begins his story as a naive child and ends it as a naive child, and even though his speech that was cut from the game saves his character slightly, it doesn't do much for him. This is worsened still by the conclusion of his mother's revenge arc, as after it's revealed that George Washington was the one who ordered for his village's destruction, Connor, for whatever convoluted reason, doesn't pursue his singular motivation that's driven him since he was a child. A lot of people miss this twist, mainly because Connor's reaction to it is so absurdly stupid, but that just brings up another issue with his story: George Washington and the rest of the War of Independence. In the rest of the Assassin's Creed series, the point of setting the games in historical time periods was always to show the hidden war between Assassins and Templars, and what truly happened during these events. Assassin's Creed 3 instead simply retells the story of the War of Independence, attempting to cram every single notable event from that time into the game's story, despite how little sense most of it makes. I could rant for a long, long time about why I despise this game, but I have 9 more games to get through, so let me just put it simply. Assassin's Creed 3 is a disaster of storytelling, and such a disappointment in both modern day plot, ancestor plot, and general gameplay, that I've got to put it effectively last out of all the games that I truly consider AC games. In my first draft of this ranking, Syndicate was at the bottom of the list, but after some thinking, surprisingly to me, it jumped up to 9th. Syndicate, to me, while still being a fairly terrible Assassin's Creed game, has more redeeming elements than AC3 and Odyssey. Firstly, the open world of Syndicate is stunning, with a huge, if slightly empty, recreation of London down to a T. Although I feel the setting wasn't necessarily right for the series, with the game needing to implement carriages and a rope launcher to be able to cross the broad streets of 19th century London, that doesn't take away from the fact that the sprawling city, when compared to 3 in Odyssey, actually feels alive, without it feeling dull to walk through the streets and see the NPCs going about their day, and without getting depressed from the bland greys and browns of revolutionary Boston and New York. The city was one thing, but it was really the gameplay, specifically the stealth and black box missions carried over from Unity, that was able to bring this game to the 9th spot. I'll get into this more when we reach Unity, but the unique assassinations, unique locations, and the freedom to go about each mission as you pleased was much more enjoyable than the heavily scripted moments from AC3 or the repetitive mission structure of Odyssey. That being said, I would by no means call Syndicate a good Assassin's Creed game. Too often feeling like a parody of the series, Quebec made the rough decision to focus most of each sequence on Jacob being an idiot, as opposed to Evie's somewhat interesting quest to find the Shroud of Eden. Along with that, the Templars in this game, all being completely fictional, are little more than cookie-cutter evil capitalists, and the story of Jacob and Evie taking over the whole of London in a 6-month span is not only ludicrous, but it's also consistently cringeworthy and boring. This game also falls into the category of boring side content, with every gameplay loop outside of the main story providing 3 total mission types with nearly no variation, and considering the game came out in the same year as The Witcher 3, that was unacceptable. Syndicate, at its very best, is an enjoyable mess, but at its very worst, it's a cringeworthy, boring, and downright tedious Assassin's Creed game. And that's why it's 9th on this list. Wait, this one counts? But it's literally 12 minutes long. Alright, fine. If I have to rank it. Back in 2014, for some clearly misinformed reason, Ubisoft decided that alongside their completely new made next-gen Assassin's Creed Unity, they should release a full $60 game on the exact same day for the Xbox 360 and PS3. And whilst on release, some saw the game as a better option than Unity, it's clear in retrospect that it was a bad decision on the part of Ubisoft. Coming off of Black Flag, Rogue essentially is a copy and paste of the previous game with a new coat of snowy paint, as it does little, if anything, in the way of gameplay upgrades. The game's positives are pretty much all drawn from Black Flag, but none of them are implemented any better, leaving it as a game that is by no means terrible, but at the same time can't stand out to be great. Ubisoft Sofia did attempt to implement some new ideas into the game though, as the player plays as assassin turned Templar Shay Patrick Cormac, an idea that could have led to the morals of the character being delved into deeply, and the gameplay to be switched up. but instead, the game simply switches the roles of each side. The assassins essentially become Templars, and the Templars become assassins, leaving Rogue to provide little in the way of uniqueness, and in the end, feeling like little more than a quick, fairly boring side game that does its job and nothing more. Now, it's here on the list where we get into the games that I truly do adore, but this one might still surprise people. I do love AC Black Flag. I think Darby McDevitt's writing with it is some of the best in the series. However, as an Assassin's Creed game, I have it lower than probably most do. Edward's personal story is done brilliantly, with the callbacks to his marriage and a great cast of supporting characters, most of whom either die or are killed at the hands of Edward. The wider narrative of the game, however, is pretty disappointing in my opinion, with a fairly forgettable group of Templars and an underwhelming set of missions. The modern day of this game is also well written, although it's clearly forced in due to Ubisoft having no idea of what to do following Desmond's death. The introduction of sages, although at first kind of interesting, ended up being fairly pointless, and this is all without going into the gameplay. Firstly, Black Flag's world is fantastic, and one of its most redeemable factors is that 100%ing the game is really fun, even though at times kind of tedious. The rest of the gameplay though, in my opinion, is either boring or just too easy. The combat mechanics are a simplified version of AC3's, which in itself was an incredibly simplified version of the Batman Arkham games. The parkour, again, is copy and pasted from AC3, and probably the biggest issue people have with the game, the mission structure is abysmal. The way the game constantly throws tailing missions at you, filled with exposition, along with stealth missions that are way too easy due to the terrible enemy AI, leads to the main story becoming boring and repetitive outside of the game's biggest selling point, the ship combat. And whilst the naval gameplay is great, personally, it just doesn't make up for all the other issues I have with the game. I do love Black Flag, despite how negative I've been about it, but I felt it necessary to justify why I have it this low in my ranking, probably very against the majority opinion. It can be fun, and it's written fantastically, but at the same time, the main story truly doesn't engage me enough to put it any higher. Now this, I'm sure, comes as a major surprise. Unity over Black Flag? Well, to be honest, it was kind of a surprise for me too when I was writing the list. But as time goes on, my absolute love for AC Unity just grows and grows. The main source of this love, I think, stems from the way this game, unlike any other, truly recaptures the feeling of what Assassin's Creed was back in 2007. From the solidified Brotherhood, the focus on stealth, the difficulty of combat, the mixture of cinematics and freedom to embrace what it is to be an assassin. Unity to me is exactly what an Assassin's Creed game should be, and what the series should have evolved into. That being said, it does have its issues. Now, despite Arno being a pretty great character, similarly to Black Flag, the story of Unity isn't as consistently great as it should be. Despite some memorable Templars such as Latouche and Robespierre, along with the fantastic, although maybe misplaced, betrayal of Belek, most of the targets in Unity are fairly forgettable. But the biggest problem comes with the main villain of the game, Germain. Here, Ubisoft attempted to make Germain a twist villain, the true Grandmaster of the Templars, but the twist comes off as confusing, rushed, and forced, with Germain never really providing any quality character moments, or even any real character traits. Arnold's relationship with Elise is another potentially great storyline, ruined by bad pacing, with the game not giving nearly enough reason to genuinely get invested in the two's romance. And then there's the issue of the game's story not having any greater impact on the overarching story. That being said though, the gameplay of Unity is, in my opinion, the best in the entire series. A completely new parkour system created limitless possibilities for movement, as the game allowed for true mastery of the free running that still has people creating videos today. The combat system is one of the most engaging in the series, with genuine challenge and the inability to take down 20 guards at once like in prior games. The long-awaited stealth system further made you feel like an assassin, as environmental stealth was given the same value as social stealth, and these systems were all brought together by the unmatched black box assassination system. And these systems were all brought together by the unmatched black box assassination system. the spiritual successor to the assassinations of the first game, and it finally created a perfect balance between immersion, freedom, and fun, providing hundreds of different ways to take out your target, and, after so long, bringing back the feeling that you were a blade in the crowd. Now, don't get me wrong, on release, and for a long, long time afterwards, this gameplay masterpiece was held down by the abysmal performance of the game, with the beautiful one-to-one recreation of Paris being so often turned into a digital disaster. The glitches, the bugs, the general lack of polish created a near unplayable game, which I was lucky enough to avoid as I didn't have a next-gen console on release. But when looking at the game now, after numerous patches and fixes, the game, although not seamless, provides an experience the likes of which can't be experienced in any of the other games in the series, or any other game in general. Assassin's Creed Unity, despite a somewhat mediocre story, despite a near unplayable launch, has climbed out of a pit of disaster to become one of my favourite games in the entire series, and I can say unabashedly that I love Assassin's Creed Unity. Now here, I wouldn't be surprised if I begin getting accused of riding on nostalgia. After all, this game was essentially the first real game I ever played. But I do genuinely believe that despite it being somewhat dated, despite it not having the technical capabilities of new games, it still perfectly embodies what makes Assassin's Creed great. There are a lot of complaints about the first AC, mainly that the gameplay is far too repetitive. And whilst it's true that the template of finding information before assassinating a target can get somewhat repetitive, in this case it is by no means bad. Each target is set up in a unique and distinguishable way, and the way that paying attention to the investigations allows for more of a variety in how you assassinate your target, similarly to Unity, creates a good balance of immersion and freedom, making you really feel like you're this masterful assassin. Altair is also one of the best characters in the series, with his arc being executed perfectly over the game. Despite being accused of being boring, the stoic arrogance of Altair isn't his static form throughout the game. Philip Shabazz gives a decent performance, as we see Altair grow from his overly arrogant, disrespectful self in the beginning of the game, to a man who, through interacting with the Templars he kills, comes to have a more nuanced view of the world, as opposed to the dogmatic black and white ideals he holds near the beginning of the game. The modern day narrative of AC1 also provides a brilliantly intriguing setup to the future games, and the Animus, despite now being used as a magical plot hole preventer, was a unique and interesting concept at the time of its release, allowing for a look into history unlike the likes of any other game at the time. Assassin's Creed will always have a special place in my heart, and if you want to see a more in-depth look at the game, then I'll link my retrospective on the first entry in a card on whichever side of the screen it's on and in the description. It's safe to say that I've already gone very in-depth into the next few games on this list, but if you haven't seen my retrospective of the Ezio trilogy, let me fill you in. Revelations, over time, has become one of the more underappreciated games in the series. Easily the best written, the essence of the other two Ezio games are brought together with that of AC1 to create a conclusion that's magnificent. The game itself is the worst out of the Ezio trilogy, due to the subpar world, the split narrative, and due to the other two simply being perfect, but that by no means takes away from the fact that Revelations is still one of the best entries in the series, and has so many fantastic moments that continue to be underrated, despite being no less incredible. Now, Origins is a game that, unlike the rest of the series, I've only played twice, and with that, I've never really spoken about it in a public sense. But Origins, despite it changing the gameplay formula significantly from what I originally loved about Assassin's Creed, is an incredible game in its own right. To be honest, when I first planned this video, I assumed the Ezio games would be far and away the top three, but the fact that Ashraf Ismail and his team were able to change the franchise yet still pay homage to what makes the series great, as well as creating a beautiful open world, as well as writing the second best character in the series. Well, to put it simply, what Ubisoft Montreal did still shocks me to this day. Bayek of Siwa is the perfect character for a modern Assassin's Creed game. Instead of attempting to recapture the magic of Ezio, as so many games did in the past, Bayek is instead a combination of the best traits of the other protagonists of the series. A fatherly figure, we see Bayek lose his son, witness the drowning of a little girl, and lose the love of his life. And despite being a stoic and strong character set on his goals, he doesn't become the statue that the likes of Connor becomes. Origins knows when to be serious with its story points and when to have fun, when to allow Bayek to show his charisma and love for the world, and when for him to be a strong leader and unstoppable force. Although the origin story of the Assassins is somewhat shallow compared to what I would have liked, the narrative of the game itself is fantastic, and the gameplay changes to me were perfect, not overstepping their bounds, but adapting the series enough for it to feel fresh. And that, mixed with the gorgeous and fascinating world of ancient Egypt, created a game so memorable that I can genuinely say it deserves the third spot on this list.
Sleep. I never sleep. I just wait in the shadows, and I will kill you all! Everyone who sniffed the air that day in Siwa!
Now we move into the top two, and if you're an Assassin's Creed fan, or if you followed my channel for any stretch of time, you probably know that these two were going to be at the top. Assassin's Creed 2, to put it simply, was a game changer for Ubisoft, creating one of the best characters and most beloved games of all time. I'm sure at this point I don't need to explain what makes AC2 great, and to rank it any lower than the second spot would be simply disrespectful to the mastermind of Patrice Désilets. To say this game is a masterpiece of storytelling is an understatement, potentially forgotten over the years due to the seemingly hundreds of formulaic copies of Ezio's revenge story. Assassin's Creed 2 provided us the birth of one of the greatest characters in all of video games, hell, in all of entertainment, and showed the potential for what the series could become. Not only this, but it provided a fantastic follow-up to the second game, building on the foundation that was laid before instead of just sweeping over it. And despite the copycats, despite the underwhelming games that the future would hold, Assassin's Creed 2 began one of the greatest trilogies of all time and will forever stand as one of the greatest games of all time. And that's why it deserves the second spot on this list.
Roma.
Welcome to the Rosa in Fiore, stranger.
Ezio!
Leonardo!
Is the world not marvelous?
Some of it.
If I want to live, I live. If I want to take, I take. If I want you to die, you die! Where is the peace of Eden?
Stop!
Give it to me. You can do with it as you will later.
Mario, our father, our brother, once stood around this fire, fighting off the darkness. Now, I offer the choice to you.
Go kill them, Mentore. Finish what you started.
Good advice.
I intend to write a book about you one day.
If you do, make it short.
I've said it before many a time, I'll say it again many a time, Assassin's Creed Brotherhood is the best Assassin's Creed game. The world of Rome is beautiful, a seamless open world, a massive sprawling city, filled with unique locations, and most importantly, packed with content. Brotherhood took everything the past two games had and ramped them up exponentially, with side content filling every corner of the game. The player can never get bored exploring Rome, going through the masterfully crafted tombs of Romulus, destroying Leonardo's war machines, seeing the story of Christina and everything in between. The main story of Brotherhood again ramps up what came before, continuing the story of Ezio versus the Borgia, but increasing the stakes, bringing about a villain less powerful and cunning than Rodrigo, but possibly no less intimidating. As we watch the parallels between Ezio's growth into a wise master assassin, growing and uniting the Assassin's Brotherhood, taking back Rome, and Cesare's descent into madness due to his lust for power. Brotherhood encapsulates everything I love about Assassin's Creed. My favorite character ever in his prime, in the midst of a true war, a grander scale war between the Assassins and Templars. Mixed in perfectly with a modern day storyline that delves even further into the lore of the Isu, of Subject 16, and climaxing with one of the most shocking moments in the franchise. Brotherhood is the closest thing Ubisoft has ever come to absolute perfection, creating the perfect balance between fun gameplay, quality storylines, great side content, and maybe most vitally, harmony between the modern day and historical plots. And it is, and probably will always be, the best Assassin's Creed game of all time. So, that's my ranking of the Assassin's Creed games. But do you agree, or completely disagree? What would you change about my list? Comment down below, because I really am interested, and I do read every single comment. Also, if you're new here, or if you enjoyed the video, it'd really be appreciated if you could hit like and subscribe. That would really help me out, because I did just restart this entire channel. With that being said, I've been Joe, aka Founded Scarab, and I'll see you in the next one.